land that we're standing on, the city of Richford, for their acknowledging the beauty of the water, for the love of the water. Also, I want to thank you for all your presence here and to understand that we all come together with thoughts of water. We're all water, we're all united with water. Every little drop of water becomes us. And when we put that together, we're all united as one. And even if you're Anishinaabe, if you're not Anishinaabe, if you're French or if you're Italian or whatever, we're all water. So I want to say that we're just one thing. Acknowledge the beauty of us. We are as human beings, that we're all partaking of the water. Also want to say we wish to the Sema that's been given to the Dasgir so that she can speak from the heart of the water. And love for the water. Or Sidney Witch also to the spirits of the song, of the words that are going to be spoken tonight. Or Sidney Witch for that. Or Sidney Witch for the spirits, because the spirits are the first ones that we think of first. When we eat, we think of the spirits. And we sing when we drum, we think of the spirits. And the first push-up of every drum song is to the spirits, and we don't get up until after the first round. So I just want to acknowledge the tonight that they've come to us tonight to hear what needs to be said on their behalf. For the spirits are very, very acknowledging of your presence here tonight. I want to say thank you much for the beauty of the water that was presented tonight for all of you, that you could feel the presence of the water inside of you when it goes into your bodies, the healing of the water. Also want to say the words for the spirit and to the tobacco. Tobacco always comes first. And I always say tobacco always comes first because in our language we say semani ladin, which means semani ladin means the tobacco always goes first before we do anything else. And we take the medicines, we offer tobacco first. And we ask an elder for helping of the tobacco first. Grandmothers accept tobacco first on behalf of the rest of these. I want to say who I am. I am who I am. I am Anishinaabe, I am Ojibwe, Anishinaabe first and foremost. That is who I am. I am from Manitoulin Island. That's where I was born. But I live in Thunder Bay now. That is where I live now. I am of a fourth degree Judaic society, which is that ceremony that I did tonight. It was a three-fire Judaic society, which was given to the Judaic people. And I'm fourth degree Judaic with the three-fire Judaic Lodge. And that ceremony was given to us by a grand chief's mothers and his grandmothers who kept the teaching for us people so that we can honor the waters, honor the sounds, beautiful sounds that have been given to us in order to acknowledge, to understand what the water means. When we sing for the water, there's many words for the sounds that we sing. There's many different kinds of water that we sing to. There's different waters that we look at. We see the water singing, we see waters. We see the water standing up, we sing. We sing for that water, we see waters running around. There's a song for that too. So there's a song for every description of the water that we sing a song for it. When I did the water walk, I developed my own songs because when you walk for the water, there's many things you see about the water. You see her laughing, you see her crying. So the songs come from the heart through the water that you're singing. And so I encourage you to do the same. To follow your heart when you're in the water. Follow your heart to be here. Tells you something. And speak to it. Speak to the water for that. For the love of the water. That's why we do our work. And I am a grandmother. I am a mother of five children. I've got seven children, three of them gone, five surviving children that I have. I have 15 grandchildren, I have 15 great-grandchildren. And I am, first and foremost, a grandmother. I'm not an elder. I don't know what the term elder means. So I call myself a grandmother. And I would appreciate you being called a grandmother also, because I am your grandmother. No matter how old you are, I'm still your grandmother. So it's one thing, another one. When I say I am who I am, I want you also to remember who you are. If you could answer that to yourselves, I am who I am. Who are you? You are a beautiful, beautiful person. You are whatever you are. If you're Italian, if you're Indian, if you're what you're going through, you are who you are. Your mother, your grandmother, your father, your grandfather, your uncle, your brother, your sisters. Whatever you are, you're many things to us, to ourselves as we see ourselves. When I first heard about the work that's to be done by the women, that was in the year 2000, when I first was given the inclination, it wasn't a direction, it was an inclination that made me, the words that came from the Grand Chief as he spoke about the water. And that is how we do our work, is we listen to the people. We listen to river, we listen to the spirits, we listen to the waters, we listen to the winds, the trees, the animals. They talk to us and tell us what to do. And so if you could open your hearts and your hearts and your hearts and your minds, your hearts and your mind, not just up here, but here also, you can really listen to anything, you can hear anything in different ways. And so when we sit on Mother Earth for 4 days, 4 nights, that's what we do, we listen. We listen with our hearts and our minds. We sit on Mother Earth, we sit on the lap, 4 days, 4 nights, without food, without water, 4 days, 4 nights. I encourage you all to do the same, if you can do that. Even if maybe it's a day, 2 days, 3 days, 4 days, you can do it. That way you can understand what we talk about when we say we love the water so much. We do anything for the water. So I encourage you to think that way, love the water, because the water is what keeps us moving, it's what keeps us alive. If we don't have water, we're not going to be able to live. We have to love the water, we have to take care of it. Just stay with your mother, if your mother is sick, or what you do, you take care of her. And so when we come to the ceremonies like this, and to the stewardship conference, we hear many things that we need to be doing for the water, for the environment. And every living thing depends on water. Every living thing, even little ants, every living thing is water. Every living thing also depends. The animals, the only water. Everybody needs water. Everything needs water, the grass. So we all need to take care of that water for the future generations. As we're seeing the water being sold out to many, many countries. I think that prostitution of our Mother Earth, that's what's happening. She's being prostituted, she's being sold out for her beauty. She's being mined, she's being gouged. The mountains are being gouged for money. We all have to remember that we have to love what it is that is being done to her, to love her, to really take care of her. We really have to understand that. When I think about how the first thought, the first words came, what are you going to do about it? That was why the walk started, was because of the words, what are you going to do about it? And I also tell you the same thing, ask you the same thing, what are you going to do about it? What can you do about the water, the weight of the water? And so that was really the motivator for the walk. And I didn't know it was going to be a walk. I didn't know what I was going to do, because the Spirit is the one that led us to do what we need to be doing. Because the message was, women have to pick up their bundles. They have to start doing what it is that they've been covered by the Creator, by the grandmother, or grandmother, to do what she needs to be doing, what we need to be doing. And so when we think about that, we think about what am I going to do? What can I do? And so when I heard that, I talked to people from across the island to ask them, what can we do about the water, so nobody can know what to do. And so when I said we have to pick up our bundles, women have to pick up their bundles, and that bundle is that bundle of life. We are the carriers of life. We carry water in our bodies for 9 months. We carry it in our wounds. We carry it in our sack for 9 months. And so that is the bundle that we carry as women. That's the very bundle that we understand that we carry that life within us. When we carry life, we carry also the life blood of Mother Earth. We also remember that we also have to understand. We have to take care of her. We have to take care of our Mother the Earth. Our mother is the one that is suffering. If your mother is suffering, you would do anything for her. Take care of her. And so when I understood that, I talked to other women about that, and nobody seemed to understand really what it means to be a water carrier, to be a life giver. And so when we sat around the house in the year 2003, two and a half years after 2008, we suddenly stopped about carrying the water, because we are carriers of life and carry the water. So how about we carry it around and disappear? So that's what we did. We said we'll carry it around and disappear. That was the first year we did that. And how it came about that the other lakes were going to be walked, we didn't know that was going to be what was going to happen. So the spirit that came through the voice of an elder. And the second day when I was water walking, the second day I had the staff in one hand, the pail in the other. And we stopped at this place where this old man came, and he said, I want to do a travel song to my son and my grandson. So the three of them had a big one, and they stopped at the side of the highway. And he said a traveling song for us. And before the song finished, a car pulled up, an old man got out of his vehicle, and he stood waiting until the drum was finished. Came over and he said, I'm so happy to see this happening. He said, my grandfather told me when I was nearby, he said, there will come a time that he wouldn't walk through the 5 degrees for the water, he said. And I looked at that young man standing beside me and said, does that mean you have to do the 5 degrees now? So the second day, and it was really hard for me to walk with a pail and a staff at the same time before it was getting ready to be tired. And so the third day, we had a lady come from Saskatchewan. She was picked up by the airport, and she helped us walk through the loop from there. We started in Bad River, Wisconsin, and we finished the loop. When she came, we went and finished the loop. And after the loop, then we started getting people from that Minneapolis youth come in a van. They helped us walk, helped the walkers walk. We have Tekla here, one of the original water walkers, first year. She walked with us, and she's the one that drove the big truck with supplies. And she was on her moon time, so she couldn't carry the water. When women are in their moon time, there's a special time that they have to step aside and let others do the work. And that is a very special time when a woman is on her moon time. She is giving her blood to Mother the Earth, that she has to settle down and be quiet. Because that's a time that she doesn't run around, she doesn't do any work around that time, because she's giving of her blood to Mother the Earth. And so we really respect that when a woman is on her moon time. Even wherever we go with ceremonies, we honor a woman and she's on her moon time. We want to do anything, we give them food, we offer them food, the water that they need. And so when we do our evening dances, we also have And so we, that's how it all started, the first year, 2003, we started the water well. The Lake Superior took a good 36 days, 37 days to cross the finish line. When we walk, we get up 3:30 in the morning. We start walking all day. And until the end of the day, when the sun goes down, we have to stop. But during the day, at noon, we have to stop because we're told by our elders is that when you're mobile, when you're up like this for a long time, your body has to recline, has to rest. Even the birds, the animals, they do that at noon, at high noon. So we are asked to do that when we do the water walk. When we honor a woman when she's on her womb time, she's very, very special for us. Because the blood is what our mother needs. She needs that blood of the young woman, especially when she's in her first period. The first time she gives her own blood, that's when we really need to honor her mother here. Because what does she give us? What's the first food she gives us? It's the strawberries. And so in turn we give her our blood, the strawberries. And so beyond the strawberries that she gives us her first food. And so when I say we love the water so much, I know for myself I would go really with the water. Would carry it as far as I need to. I had a call from a young man. He said the Nile River is very sick. He said he had people from the Nile, the Egyptians, came to South Carolina where he lives. They were talking about the water. And he asked me if I could help him with the Nile River. I said I can't walk the Nile River. Because I've always My intent is to walk wherever I can walk from. I can't go any place where I cannot walk from. That's my intent is to walk, not swim, not drive, or go by plane. So to walk in the water, that's my work, I guess. And even though I'm limping, I had knee surgery. I have total knee replacement, and I'm learning to walk all over again, but I'm getting stronger with exercise. If I exercise, I feel a lot better. But when I travel, I can't exercise, so I sit, I drive. And that's not good for my body either, because my body has to keep moving, has to keep exercising. And so the walk has really helped me in terms of how I can look at the water. When I walk with the water and I see the water along the highways, I see that it's really sick. And I see plastic on the highways. I see diapers. I see sanitary napkins. I see all kinds of things along the highway, cigarette butts. And those things should not be on the highways. They should not be in the ground because Mother Earth is suffocating because of that. If I wrapped you in plastic, how long would you last? Not very long. And the same with the water that's in the bottles, plastic bottles. The plastic bottles that are really, it's not really good water that you're drinking. And so I encourage you not to drink plastic water, because it's plastic water that you're drinking. If you can, if you're able to take the water out of the plastic and leave it outside for overnight or whatever, 24 hours, in a glass jar, or glass tumbler, and that the energy from the earth will give that cleanliness that it needs. And so there's many ways that we have to honor the water, how to take care of the water. We have to also know where the spring waters are. We have to know where to get the water. I've traveled many, many places of Great Lakes area. I know where the fresh water is because of the people that I speak to. They tell me where the fresh water is. So I know where to get the fresh water by any means. But then again, you have to think of groundwater, because groundwater can also be poisoned by the environment, by the animals, by the farms. And it was really interesting this morning when I heard this talk about the cattle that are polluting the waters, groundwater. So we have to really, really be careful to where the water comes from. And so when we look at water, we really, really know how to take care of the water. You should know how to take care of that water. How can I take care of the water? Who am I? Who am I? Ask yourself. Who am I? Can I take care of the water? So I ask you, what are you going to do about the water? What are you going to do about it? And so when we walked around the Lake Michigan, we also saw many things that we walked around Lake Michigan. We saw the signs of our ancestors on the rocks, on the trees. We saw many, many signs that they had left us. And so our legacy is to show our grandmothers, our grandmothers, grandfathers, our future generations, 7 to 7 generations. We have to show them that we're doing our best. So they can look back at us and say, this is what they did for us. This is, they helped us, give us this water that we're drinking. That's what they did. We don't want them to say, oh, they polluted the water. I see many, many things that are happening to our waters. But even the people that I love and I trust, they're still selling off the water. They're allowing mine companies to come to frack the water. There's all kinds of things that they're doing to the water, which is not good. And so we have a responsibility to take care of water, to love that water, to really, really care for it. And I really mean to care for it, because the water that you drank tonight was just a little bit. And that little bit has really, really helped you understand that water is very precious. When you sit on Mother Earth 4 days, 4 nights, you really appreciate that first drink of water. After 4 days, 4 nights without food and water, your first drink is really, really precious. And the same with the first food. First food is a strawberry that you're given after you fast. That first food is really precious also. And so we learn something when we sit on Mother Earth 4 days, 4 nights. We learn something from her. We learn how to listen, how to open our faculties. When we're born into this world, we're given 4 gifts. Although 9 months you're in the womb, 9 months you're picking up a lot of invisible gifts of sight, of hearing, of taste, of feeling, of touch, your sight, your hearing, all kinds of things that you're learning when you're in the womb for 9 months. And so when you come out, you're given 4 physical gifts. First gift is your name, your nose ring. Your card nose ring, that's the first gift that you're given. And then you give the other gift is your very, very is the sound that you make. If you're Italian, you make an Italian sound. If you're Indian, you make an Indian sound. That's the language that you carry. And the third gift is a day, which is the heartbeat. When a little baby who's never heard a drum hears the drum for the first time, they want to dance. And the feet go, they want to dance. So they know, they've been in the womb for 9 months, they've heard that heartbeat for them. And when they hear it, they really want to be a part of the drum. And the fourth gift that we're given is our Dokonote, which is that spirit that is within us, around us. That spirit that walks with us when we journey. Spirit that dreams for us, the dream that travels with us, travels for us when we're sleeping. So when we're sleeping, the spirit travels. And when you wake up, the spirit is already there. My uncle told me one time that the spirit never leaves you. But if you're drinking, it leaves you. You're under the alcohol, under the influence of alcohol and drugs, the spirit leaves you. But it's never far away, he says. Maybe in the bush area somewhere, maybe it's waiting for you to smarten up. And so it comes back. And so when it comes back, you feel remorse. You feel bad about what you did. And so that's the Spirit speaking to you. Spirit trying to tell you you're a good person. So you have to remember that you're a good person no matter what you did. You're still a good person. And so my uncle Dominic used the analogy of a dog. Said not to offend his spirit, he said, but just like a dog, when a master abuses his dog, the dog runs away and he's out in the bush. But he comes back sneaking back every once in a while, checks on his master, see if he's okay. And if he's still not okay, he still runs away and then comes back. Next day, 2 days later, he comes back and checks up on his master. And if the master's okay, then they're okay. And then he's happy. He jumps on his master and licks his wounds and really, really happy to see his master happy. So the dog's best friend, you've heard that. The dog's best friend. The dog's your best friend. Human's best friend is your dog. And so when we acknowledge our spirit, that's the four visible gifts that you're given when you come out of the womb after 9 months, those four gifts. And those four gifts are what you carry through your life. Your name, your spirit, your heart, and your name, your heart, your spirit, name, your nose, your language, and your spirit. Those four gifts are what you carry through life. Every one of us, each and every one of us has those four gifts. You have to acknowledge those gifts. Almost. When you sit on Mother Earth, that's what you're thinking of. You honor those, you wake up your senses. And every time you sit on Mother Earth for 4 days, 4 nights, I go 4 days, 4 nights, four times a year, every season I go fasting. And then I know I can hear different things. I can hear the birds singing, I can hear the animals calling, I can understand what they're saying. And so when you're in tune with Mother Earth, you're in tune with all universe. When we travel, we know the winds. The winds carry our tobacco prayers. They know the winds. I know the winds in the trees. The trees talk to each other and they know that we're coming along the highway. And I tell them not to let the animals go on the highway, so I don't want to hit anybody, I don't want to kill anybody. And so that's the message that the winds and the trees tell the other trees that they're coming. Vidasthi is coming. She's going to cross the highway. They tell them here that the deer looks at us around the highway. They won't run across. That's they've been told not to run across. And you hear many people who hit deer, who hit animals on the highway. Why do they do that? Because they have not given their tobacco. They've not offered their tobacco to the journey. And so everything we do, we have tobacco for everything we do. I don't know if you understand what tobacco is. Tobacco is very, very special for us Anishinaabe people. It should be to you too. It's not something that you smoke up. It's something that you really respect. You give it to the earth. You give it to the pipe. If you have a pipe, you smoke it in the pipe. And our tobacco is homegrown. We started using homegrown tobacco now for the past, I would say 20 years, 15, 20 years in a lodge. And even in our people, we don't use store-bought tobacco because we know there's chemicals in that tobacco. We don't use that tobacco, we use homegrown. I encourage you to grow your own tobacco and to offer to the spirits. Because the spirits acknowledge your tobacco when it's burned in the fire. The spirit acknowledges it goes in a circle like that. It's perpendicular, it goes up. And the Creator accepts your tobacco. And when your tobacco is burned, then the spirits come and acknowledge your tobacco as it is burned. And so when we really honor our tobacco, we really honor the spirits and the elements, the four elements, water, the earth, fire, and the earth. So we really have to respect those things that have been given to us freely. We're given we could have to resell that was freely, given to us freely. Everything that we have is given to us freely, the air, water, the air, the land, the trees, everything is given to us freely. And why are we selling it? Because we have to make money. But also, we really have to make money. Is it really necessary for us to sell off the forest, trees, the land, the rocks, the diamonds, the gold, the copper? We really have to do that. Because it should stay on the earth, it should stay the way it is. That's what I, and when I see, I love, my love for the water is so great that I know that the waters, that the rocks form the waters. If you see the rocks, if you look at the rocks, you can see the water coming from the rocks. But inside the rocks, there's water there. So if they frack and if they kill off the mountains, they're killing off all the water. There's no place that the water is going to take care of itself. Because the rocks are very important. The rocks can plant trees. You see cedar trees, you see pine trees growing out of nothing, out of a rock, because there's water there. You know, there's water there. So it's very important that we learn to love every bit of water, every little bit of water that you see. Love that water. Even if the water is not moving, put the back in the water, you can see the back will start to move. And you know that water is alive, it's going to come alive. You pray for it, you sing for it. You do something for the water, and they will take care of you. And so I want to really encourage you to love the water. Love it as much as you love your mother. When we walked Lake Michigan, we saw signs that told us that we really are, have been taken care of by our ancestors. They have messages for us. So we know that we need to be doing the same thing for our children, our grandchildren. We need to leave messages for them, that we're doing everything we can for the water. Leave messages for them. Leave your footprints wherever you go and show that you're thinking of the next generations. When we did Lake Huron, that was the time when the men woke up. We woke up the men. Because when we only had one young man walk with us the first 2 years, first 2-3 years. And when we, Lake Huron, we went to this place called Mountain Whitefish Lake Reserve. And there was a meeting there of chiefs of Ontario. You know, Ontario Indians were eating. So they invited us to go and have lunch with them. So we had lunch with them, and I talked to them about the water and how we as women, we don't have any men walking with us. And so the next day we saw young men standing, waiting for us, sitting on the rocks, waiting for us to start. Well, we slept in that morning too. He said, you thought we started at 3:30? He said, no. Well, we slept in. So anyway, he started, and then from then, that's when the men started walking with us. We had men all over Lake Huron. We had men started walking. And ever since then, men too have started walking. Because we need that balance. That balance has to be there. In all that we do, we have to have balance. The men have to start doing their work for the women. They can't just impregnate the woman and walk away. They need to be there for them. So we told them that we need to have men walk with us. We need to have that balance. The yin and yang, you know what yin and yang is. We need that balance of male and female. And so that's what we gave to the men. And so now men are very supportive of the water walk. And they really beginning to understand that they have to start doing their work, to start being fathers, to start being grandfathers, to start being uncles and brothers to the women, to the young children. And so when we really woke them up that, am I putting you to sleep? So I was going out. Anyway, and then Lake Ontario was another lake that we found that the lake was really polluted. It was so polluted that we didn't even touch the water with our feet, because when we so funny, because when we saw, when we, especially on the New York side, after travel, walked on the New York side, we saw the waters really, you just see the shimmering of the water, how polluted it was. And that was the year that one of our girls was saying that the water's so heavy, she said, my shoulders are really hurting. And we noticed that water was getting heavy. A year later, I got an article from Hamilton, and the scientists did research on the water. They tested the water, and it was labeled heavy water. So we knew that it was heavy water. Heavy water because all the chemicals that are mercury, potassium, all kinds of stuff that's in the water, they found that was heavy water. So we knew that before the scientists knew. And we also know that Dr. Moto was the one who brought out the crystals, water that he froze, crystals. We knew that when you love the water, it'll hear you. You can listen, you can feel, you can feel the water, it can hear you. If you say good things to it, it'll be that way. If you say bad things to it, it'll be bad things. That's why a lot of our water is so polluted, because of the way that the humans are treating the water, fracking, the terrible things that they're doing to the water. So the water is really suffering them. And so we have to turn around and love that water, give it the love that we need. We need to give all the love that we need for the water. Every little crack and creak around, patty that you see in a puddle of water, you can walk around that puddle and say that I love you. I love you because that water is really precious. Learn to swim in that water. You know, you have to really understand that water is so precious. And we need to really take care of the water. And so when we hit Lake Erie, Lake Erie was a very shallow lake. It was really, really, it turned really brown, almost like shit water, that the water was so polluted that we really didn't. We saw people swimming in the water, and we saw, I don't know how they could do that, because it's really, really muddy, dirty water. And so when we, and that was a really hard lake that we walked down around, because people made fun of us. We called us dirty Indians. We called us stupid Indians. We called us, you know, they did the war whoop sign, which is, you know, as we were walking in, two trucks came by one day, and they said, get a job. The young man that was walking with me, he's a very professional man, and only made lots of money. And he came and walked with us for a week. He said, if they only knew how much money I make, he said, they probably won't even make any money as much as I do. Anyway, that I told him not to get upset about it, because they probably don't know what they're doing. They probably don't understand what we're doing. We're walking by the water, I told him. And so that love for the water has carried me many, many places, many ceremonies, many conferences like this that I've been to. And we walked, after we finished the Five Great Lakes, I went to a conference in Cornwall, and Henry Vickers is his name. He said, so you did all the Five Great Lakes, eh, Josephine? He said, but you're not finished yet. The Five Great Lakes go down the St. Lawrence River, he said. So I went home and I told my Amiga that. I said, why doesn't he walk? So we did the St. Lawrence River the following year. It was 2009, I think we walked the St. Lawrence River. And so we finished that. And then after that, we got another word from the salt water people, the oceans. They said the oceans need to be acknowledged too.